Hi, everybody. Debi here with a announcement and a talk about something that's just really bothering me lately, and it's Walgreens. Now, while I don't do any narcotics at the moment at Walgreens, Walgreens, to me, is the worst, the worst pharmacy in the history of mankind. Walgreens acts as if they're doing you a favor if they are filling your prescription. They act as if they have the say-so on whether or not your prescription gets filled. I think they actually like to mess with people who need prescriptions. I honestly do. And what gets me about that is this. What gets me about that is that if you need a prescription filled, it's almost as if they toy with you. I can't understand how I'm trying to put this. Let me think what I'm trying to say. Okay, for example, I had a prescription called in this afternoon by my doctor. Okay, I called my doctor. I said, I'm out of my prescription. No problem. We'll call you in a refill. What pharmacy do you use? I said, I use Walgreens. Well, we call Walgreens and first I say, well, she doesn't have any refills. And I'm like, I understand that. And then they say, well, we see on here, you know, it takes us 20 minutes, Vic and I both, 20 minutes to go back and forth with these idiots. And finally, this woman goes, well, let me check the telephone call-in, whatever you want to call it, and see if there's anything on there. So she checks, and sure enough, she finds where my doctor called in 6 hours ago, no, 7 hours ago, a refill for my prescription. And she goes, well, it'll be ready in a few hours because we're really backed up. I mean, does that make sense to you? If it were me, I would say, okay, this person called in. We obviously dropped the ball. We did not check the phone answering machine thingy, whatever you want to call it. So therefore, they would move my prescription up to the first in line. But no, they don't act like they can do that. I honestly feel, I swear to you, I'm not kidding, I honestly believe that Walgreens is evil. I believe that. I really do. I believe that. I totally believe that they're evil. And they actually mess with people on purpose. And they do it and they get their jollies out of it. I think it gives them some sort of sense of control or something. And I've never really understood that. I don't understand that. I don't understand why it seems like living in today's world, so many people feel like evil is cool. It's cool to be evil. I feel sorry for those people. I really do. I pity them. And I'll tell you what I mean. There is a person that works. Okay, one of Stephen's friends lives at an apartment complex. Okay, his name is Tyler. Tyler lives in an apartment complex. And Tyler said that there's a girl that works there that cannot stand everybody, and she's evil. And she called him at 5:29 on Friday to tell him that his electricity was going to be turned off if he didn't contact the office. Well, they closed at 5:30. So he had to stay with Stephen all weekend because they turned his electricity off. Now, that was done with malice on purpose to be evil. I honestly think that there's something wrong with people today. I think that people have been fooled into thinking that being evil is cool. And that's a sad state of affairs. That is a sad, sad state of affairs. If people believe in their heart that, oh, well, I've got a long life to live. I'm young. I'm only 28. I'm only 34. I'm only whatever. I'm going to live a lot longer. My parents lived a long time. No, you don't know that. You don't know that. And a lot of people think that, well, I've got plenty of time to ask for forgiveness. I'll straighten up and be a nice person, but I don't feel like doing it right now because I actually get a kick out of being evil to people because somebody was evil to me. So I feel like the world owes me. The world owes me. I get my rocks off. I get my jollies being evil to people is what they think. I know how they think. That's got to be the only real rationalization that they can give. And I'm not so much talking about people online. People online do it too, but people in real life do it too. And so it is with that, when I find somebody that's really sweet and genuine, I really, really go out of my way to say things to them that are nice, like, thank you, you don't know how much I appreciate what you've done, blah, 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 because I think that that's warranted today. I mean, the people online are messed up beyond description. But you have to wonder in your heart, what makes people like that? Why are people mean? What makes a person mean? What makes them think evil thoughts? And I know a lot of people are not thinking that evil means satanic. Evil means beyond mean. It's the evil, it's the meanest of the mean. You know what we do all the time on the show? We get the Webster's Dictionary and we look up the term evil. Evil as defined by Webster's Dictionary says, profoundly immoral. I never can say this word. Let me try it. Now let me get the reader to read it. Ah! It just fell off. Hold on. I'm trying. Well, I can't highlight it. No, I just did. All right. What does this say, reader?
Profoundly immoral and malevolent.
Profoundly immoral and malevolent. Harmful or tending to harm. Wicked. And I think that so many people are like that today. I mean, I think that people think that don't worry about doing something. Because I think most people out there do believe that there's a heaven and a hell. They won't admit it because they think it's cool to not believe in a heaven and a hell. Okay? All I know is to believe I'm following the rules. I'm believing the Bible. That's what I'm doing. That's how I'm living my life. I'm going to believe what the Bible says. Now, the Old Testament is not so much what I live by. I live by the New Testament. Because if we live by the Old Testament, I would have probably already killed both of my children and felt good about it. Or cut off my hands or something weird like that. I just think that that was a long time ago. And when Jesus came, he was more or less thinking future-wise. And I don't care what anybody says. I really don't care what anybody says. I believe that most people believe that. I think they believe in what the Bible says. They will not admit it. They won't admit it. And a lot of people base their life on, well, I'm young, so I can be evil now. And then when I get old, like my grandma, I'll ask for forgiveness and I'll lead a nice life. Well, that's not the way it works. Because see, God sees right through your heart. He sees right through you and he knows what you're doing. And if you deliberately commit sin or evil acts towards people, whether you work at Walgreens or whatever, or in an apartment complex or whatever, or if you're a commissioner or whatever, if you do things that are evil towards people, you will not get away with that. I don't care who you are. You won't get away with it. Because if you don't believe in God, then you must believe in the theory of karma. Okay? Now, I know there's been a lot of trolls online that have said, oh, well, we got Debi and she lost her business and she lost her house. No, Debi sold her house. I sold my house. I started talking on my show and telling people in the month of July that I was trying to sell my house, that my children had moved on, off to college and off to better and bigger things, and that Victor and I did not need a 5,000 square foot house. And we sold it and we did really good on it. You don't live in a house as long as we lived in and not sell it and not walk away with a gigantic check full of what do you call it? I never can think of that word. Money that you have in the house. We made out pretty good. And it is with that we went on and did what we purchased where we're at now. But anyway, that's beside the point. But I think that there's people out there that even take credit for evil that don't know what they're talking about. They'll say, oh, well, we cost her business. No, nobody cost us our business. Nobody did. Our business was affected by an evil commissioner in Dallas named John Wiley Price. And it looks like karma's coming back to kick John Wiley Price's ass because he's probably going to go to federal prison. He has been indicted for a 67-page account. A 67-page indictment. I believe it is a total of 5 counts of bribery, money laundering, racketeering. He's horrible. And he got a red ass at Victor in the year 2012 because Victor wouldn't pay to play and would not grease his palm to the tune of $5,000 at his Kwanzaa Fest, that he called it, which is his birthday celebration. And so Victor got blackballed out of the community. But we circled around and we came right back under him with a different and a bigger and a better situation that we're in now. Good will always prevail over evil. It's just the law of nature. Cream always rises to the top. The sun always shines. The sun always rises. I mean, you can't keep a good man down. There's all kinds of sayings for that. Evil will never, ever win. Evil actually loses in the end. If there is such a thing as the end of the world, evil loses there. Evil will always lose. I have seen evil come at me, and what I mean by evil is, like we talked about a second ago, profound wickedness, profound meanness, a little bit over and above just being mean, okay? I've seen it come at me, and it will always appear to win. It will always appear that it's won. Oh, I got her, or oh, I got him. And then it never fails. They always lose in the end. Always. There was a guy on this network who came at me in the most evil and vindictive way. I'll tell you who it was. Jay Sands. And he thought he was Mr. Hot Shot. Ooh, boo, boo. He was Mr. Big Shot. And now look at Jay. He's a joke. Nobody listens to Jay. And that's because I just sat back and I let it happen. And anytime you have somebody that does something evil to you, do not get revengeful. Do not. Because revenge is mine, so saith the Lord. Or if you don't believe... Can I help you? If you don't believe in God, basically what you're looking at is good karma versus bad karma. Okay? Meaning that if somebody does something ugly to you, don't do anything about it. Just sit back and watch. It could take a while. I had in my real life a girl come at me that I thought was an absolute you-know-what. She walked into a party of all of my friends one time and announced, oh, I hear Debi and Victor are in trouble with the IRS in front of everybody that we knew. And Annette takes her into the kitchen and she goes, how do you know about this? Well, this girl worked at Collin County and she saw some paperwork come over her desk. And she was like, you know, are you supposed to be talking about this? Well, It upset me. She was wrong. And it greatly upset me. I did not do anything in revenge. But to her demise, that girl ended up divorced, living in a shanty little apartment. Her children quit speaking to her, and she is still struggling to this day. And she was living high on the hog. I've seen people come at me before that have risen in evil or whatever, trying to hurt me, and then I've sat back, not done a thing about it, and watched them fall. And it's the same for everybody. It is the same for everybody. It's sort of like, just let karma take care of them. Now, in my world, I say it differently. Yes, dear. Yes. I have to play something. I don't have anybody on the show with me. What? Hold on. Okay, anyway, I'm back. Things could get rough here in a little while. Anyway, I'm back. I want you all guys to know how much I hate Walgreens. So I thought we might troll Walgreens. Anybody want to do that? Let me call a couple of Walgreens and just tell them what I think about them. How about that? Let me see. What can I say? We'll call a Walgreens 24-hour. Okay. Here we are, Walgreens 24-hour stores. Here's one right here. Let's call and give them a hard time. What can we say? We'll just start asking them a bunch of stupid questions and just wear them out. Okay, let's do that. First, we're going to add the number to the call. Oh, I'm not on the call. Oh, how about that? I'm not even on a Skype call. I thought I was on a Skype call. Let's see. Let's just call them. Here we go. We're going to mess with Walgreens. Why? Because we can.
Thanks for calling Walgreens at the southwest corner of Matilda Street. I see you're calling from a doctor's office. If you'd like to leave a message for the pharmacy, say leave a message or press 1. To submit a new prescription or ask a clinical question, say pharmacist or press 2. To authorize a refill or for general questions. All right, one moment while I connect you to a pharmacist.
How do they know I'm calling from a doctor's office?
Please remain on the line to speak with a member of our staff.
How would they know I'm calling from a doctor's office? Why would they say you're calling from a doctor's office? That ever happened?
Thank you for calling Walgreens. May I help you?
Yes, hello. We were wondering, do you have Prozac?
The brand name?
Yes.
Okay, yeah, because generic, we have plenty. And the brand name Prozac, what strain are you looking for?
The big one.
The 40 milligram?
No, do you have 80?
80, I have not seen the 80.
I mean, excuse me, Prozac. That would be 40. Do you have the brand?
No, I don't. I just have some of the 10 and some 20, but no 40s.
Okay. Do you have any Vicodin, the brand name Vicodin?
What strength?
10 milligram. 10-300? Yes.
Yeah, I do.
You have the brand name?
Yes, ma'am. Uh-huh.
Okay. And can you tell me how much it would cost to write a prescription for 120?
For 120 would be $307.19.
Okay, is that $307.19? Okay.
Uh-huh.
Now, if we order that, is there a way for us to order for a patient of ours liquid Vicodin? Is that possible?
No, we don't have the liquid Vicodin. They have the, let me see, the brand name, of course, out of the question, we don't carry that at all. The Jeanette, let me see. Jeanette, we don't have the 10 milligram. We just have the equivalent of the 7.5, 325.
Okay. Okay. Thank you. I'll call you back.
Bye.
He sat there and said that he had the brand name and he didn't have the brand name. See, they're idiots. They're absolute idiots. I wonder why he said, I'm calling from a doctor's office. Maybe I should call in some fake prescriptions for a bunch of people and see if that works. I'll just call them and say, yes, I'd like to call in a prescription for, last name is Wayne, first name is John. And that will be hydrocodone quid times 60. Isn't quid four times a day? Quid, or see, what is it, as needed? Isn't that, I forgot, I have to look all that up. It's like, don't they speak in Latin? Let me see, how do you call in a prescription? Let's see how I can find that. I'll do it. How to call in. I'll probably have the cops at my door in a couple of hours. Maybe I better not do that. yes. Did you call in a prescription? No. I wonder how they trace a Skype call. My, like they can't. Anyway, so moving right along. I did a show one time. It was pretty funny. I was listening to it earlier. It was with me and Goose, and it was funny. I was listening to it a little bit earlier. I didn't get through much of it, but it was pretty funny. Where did it go? I forgot what I did with that. Oh, what did I do with that? I totally forgot. Oh, also, I think I know who Jack Me Off is. I'm pretty sure I know who Jack Me Off is. In fact, I'm positive I know who Jack Me Off is. I'm I'm pretty positive. Does anybody remember when I did a show called The Daily Quagmire? The Daily Quagmire was a show I did with a friend of mine who is still a friend of mine to this moment, Laszlo Quagmire, and we did a show. It was his idea. It went off pretty good, and we just fell by the wayside, didn't do it anymore, but let's listen to some of The Daily Quagmire starring Debi and Laszlo. It's a pretty funny show. Let's listen to some of this, okay? Yes, I got scared watching that movie. Let me tell y'all something, people. Do not watch The Conjuring. I swear to God. Fufu got so scared, she jumped up in my lap. I swear to God, Fufu jumped up in my lap on the couch. She started looking around the room like she was seeing ghosts and stuff. The Conjuring is, I would go so far as to say it's almost worse than The Exorcist. I'm not lying. It's pretty tough. It's a story of a house that gets invaded by demons. And I could talk all about that, but y'all would think I'm nuts, but I'm going to go ahead and play some of this. The lines are open on Skype. The number is 214-444-5488. And I did learn how to put some reverb on my voice and on your voice. If you want to call, call. If not, don't. Here's a little bit from the show that aired April 16th of the year 2013. Here is Debi and Laszlo with The Daily Quagmire. Enjoy. I'll be right here if you want to call.
Do that.
Now, can you imagine a camera team at Todd Morris's house, one at Goofy Bone's house, one at your house, one at my house, one at Katie's house, one at this house and that house and the other house, and all put it together? It looked like a more American Graffiti is what it'll end up look like. Did I say look like? I didn't mean that. Looking like.
I like look liking.
I do too.
Well then, it is now a part of the Spanglish language.
The Spanglish language.
Or Laszlo language.
Yes, it might be Laszlolian, but I'm not sure yet.
I got to tell y'all something funny. I was thinking about having somebody call in as a joke to pretend that they were a witness to that bombing out there, but I thought, Debi, that's not funny. Then the you know, you have the Secret Service calling you or whatever, calling your show. One time when we were in terrestrial radio, the one of the floods was going on around. I don't remember. It was one of the hurricanes. We had that gigantic fan that we rented from. I said, you can rent those at Home Depot. So they go and they rent one, and it's this huge fan. And the guy was going to stand in front of it and, you know, talk like he was at the hurricane.
Right.
And we almost got electrocuted, but I told y'all that story already. Remember?
Yeah, when you were outside under the tower.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Right there at the corner of 35 and Regal Row.
Yeah, bad spot to stand. You know, they have to shut those towers down when people climb up them because, like, the one for the police station, for instance, if you climb that tower and somebody keys a mic, it can just fry you.
Oh, wow. I never knew that.
Yeah, just like grabbing a hold of an electric cable.
That is amazing.
Yeah, it's even more amazing when you see it happen and watch the guy falling from the sky. It's also the last time you want to see it, trust me. It's gross.
I am going to make a couple of T-shirts. If anybody's interested in them, y'all give me a call or send me an email. Do something. I don't know. Whatever. Send me a page me on my pager and put in 7707. Remember we used to put in I love you? I love you was...
143.
No. You turned your pager upside down and it said the words I love you and it was... It was... what was it? Or I love. I know that love was 3. What was the V? I don't remember. It did look right, though. You know the funniest thing I ever did with my pager? I had a gold one, a little bitty one. It was so pretty. And David, my brother, every time there was a good song on 92.5, he would send me a page that says 92.5. He was such a dodo, snooty bones.
I really love that station, by the way. And if we could get on there,
oh.
I'd do it for free.
I would do it for free. Mm. Classic rock. It's the only thing I know. It's the only thing worth knowing. I want to show y'all something funny. You mentioned a techno song, David.
Yeah.
One night, I want y'all to listen to this one. One night, I got to do some segue here. One night on a broadcast, Wild Goose was calling in, and he was trolling me to death, okay? Just this and that. He was drunk. And it was funny. He's calling in, and every time I pick up his call, he'd go, what? What? Because I'd go, well, Goose, you're back on the air with Debi. He'd go, what? What do you want? And it was just, the banter back and forth was really, really funny. Well, he sends me a link to a song, because I said, oh, my God, y'all guys are driving me crazy. And the name of the song was this one, and it's called, no. He said this. He plays the song, that's right. He goes, Debi. I go, what? He goes, just enjoy the abuse. And he takes the song.
Following tonight, so it's pretty cool.
Yeah, Jesus Superstar, hit 1 to raise your hand, and then Debi will pick you up.
Yeah, here we go. We've got
dogs.
Okay, Ryan, you're on the board with Debi and Jane and Goose.
Hi.
Hi.
Oh, sorry, hold on. Is this Slaughter?
Yeah, you're fine. What's up?
All right. I just had a quick question. So you guys had a paranormal thing going on?
Mm-hmm. What's up?
Can I ask a paranormal question of you guys?
You sure can.
All right. Well, I was making out with my girlfriend the other day, right?
Mm-hmm.
And all of a sudden the phone rang, and I answered it, and this voice just said, you know, what are you doing with my daughter? And I hung up immediately, and I just turned to her, and I said, you know, she said, who was that? I said, it was your dad, and she goes, but my dad is dead. Who was the phone?
Wow.
Who was phone?
Who was phone?
Who was phone?
I don't know. I'm disappointed over the host, the whole call. Are you disappointed, Jane?
word. Who was phone?
If you don't mind, I'm going to turn that over to our paranormal specialist. Specialist. His name is Wild Goose 88. Goose, would you answer the man's question for him?
I'm sorry. I guess I'm the de facto paranormal specialist. What was the question?
Okay.
Phone?
Yeah, I was making out with my girlfriend, and she, you know, the phone rang, and I picked it up. And she said, what are you doing with my daughter? And I just turned to her and
you phone's know, ringing.
I noticed. She asked me who it was, and I said it was her dad, and she said her dad was dead. So who was phone?
You know, it's a complex issue because you have her dad on the... All right, what you're saying is that her dad was on the phone, but you thought she was making out with her dad?
No. Her dad said her dad was dead.
You idiot.
Okay, well, spell it out for me. Spell it out for me. All right, who was she making out with?
You guys know every fucking meme, and I hate it.
Yeah, it's not really going to work too well.
It's ruining my life.
I'm
Debi,
sorry.
You're fantastic. I love this show.
Well, you call back anytime, Ryan. Secret. It's code 913. Ready? On 3, 2, 1, you're on the air. You're on the air, 913. Now you're not.
Oh, hello? Am I on the air?
Okay. What's up?
No, that was me, Deb. That was you.
I know, darling. I know. 77. You know what? You should try to hang up and try to troll me back, and I guarantee I can tell your voice every time. 770, you are on the air.
Ooh, yeah. That's hot. Are you fasting?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Teach that weenos in class. Yeah, buddy. Get into this, man.
Fuck.
All right, faster. What? Faster. Like, ease into it. Not too fast.
Right.
Might get a little rug burn there. Are you good? Are you all right, man?
Yeah, I'll let him work on it. Just stay with it, 770. I didn't hang up on you. I put you back on hold. Letter A, you are on the air with Debi and Jane and Goose.
Hello.
You guys call her.
Go ahead. We can hear you.
Is this Jane?
Hello.
Good caller.
Hello.
Give us a number between 1 and 10.
11.
That's you, 11. What's up?
Hey, how you going, Debi? It's Vince from Australia.
Ah.
Oh, Vince. How are you?
I'm good.
Where the fuck is Matt?
Now, before I even continue to play this, I guarantee you that Vince is going to request that I play Timey Kangaroo Down Sport.
What?
Where's Matt? We want Matt.
Where's Matt?
Oh, Matt was awesome.
I don't know. I heard he was a bit of a faggot. But just so you understand the shit I was saying before, I understand your little friend there wanted to, I don't know, confront me or something. But just so you understand where I'm coming from, I'll just tell you a little bit about myself. I'm Vince. I'm part of your average family. I've got a bunny. We found him. And Darwin, he found us. About our house, it moves because we travel all over the world. You see, my dad holds this nature show, and my mum, she shoots it. Okay, so we're not that average. But between you and me, something amazing happened.
God.
And now I can talk to animals.
It's, like the 50th
it's pretty cool
time
and totally
secret. Been done.
And you know what? Life has never been the same.
Off the air, summer fag. Turn off the voice oscillator.
Well,
you don't sound that sexy.
Area code 785.
We'll talk about Spike, Debi.
All right, 785. You're on the air with Vince, and or, I don't know who you're on the air with. Who you're on the air with? Go 785.
Oh, konnichiwa. Gomenasai sukino desu.
Yeah. Get over and touch your toes. I'll show you where the wild goose goes.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Ah. Yeah.
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 Yeah. Pedicure?
Oh, yeah. You like that?
You want pedicure? You want pedicure?
You want freestyle shika?
Konnichiwa.
You want egg roll up that?
Sushi.
Number two, goddammit.
Yeah, keep talking that fake Ching Chong language. That really gets me off. I have the weirdest boner right now.
You want fried rice with that? Fried or steamed?
Yeah, yeah. I like your fried rice. I like your lumpia. Are you gone?
Goose, listen.
Gretchen want number two.
870, you're on the air with Goose.
Hi, I'm going off to college pretty soon, and I don't really, I'm just having trouble, because I realized lately that I really don't have any goals, and I'm just wondering, do you have any goals?
By goals?
Like, go fuck yourself.
Goals lame, man. No, goals just another, like, it's just as bad as fiat currency. It's another thing that is baseless. It doesn't have any real value. You could say that, well...
Okay. How are we going to judge a good troll from a bad troll? I think they're all bad right now. But so I love the way Goose can call them. That's what I like. And Jane called one, and you can call. I can call some, but not as many as y'all call.
All right, Debi. Did you guys happen to hear Melissa's son call it?
Was that you?
No.
I thought it was Melissa. It sounded just like Melissa.
No, I have a voice oscillator. I forget what it's. Let me see. It's
bring her back.
Screaming bee. Yeah, I can turn it on.
We have a pit bull. Pit bull me too. Pit bull me too. Pit. Okay. Pit. You're on the line.
How are you guys doing?
We're doing fine.
Oh, that's good.
He sounds like he's down in a well.
I am.
Hey.
Help me.
Hey. Is this Timid Dawkins?
Yes, it is.
Where the fuck is Matt?
This is Timothy Hopkins.
Timothy Hopkins.
My mom still breastfeeds me, and she gets drunk every night and goes and listens to the...
Goose. I'm going to answer the call again, and you be that, okay? We have an area code coming out of the East Coast, and it says Timothy Hopkins. Hello, this is Debi and Jane.
Hi, Debi. Hi.
Hi.
No, I tuned into your show last night because my mom was letting me stay up and listen to it. I couldn't go to sleep. It was too hot. And I heard that the bad lady called my mommy an old hag and a bitch. And I don't really know what all those words mean, but I don't think they sounded kind of ugly, to be honest.
Guess what, Timothy? I actually had that, like, on the line with me.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah, your mom is an old fucking hag.
That's mean. Why are you saying those things?
Fucking whore.
She's my mom, though.
Why aren't you in bed, Timothy?
Because I need to get my milk.
So badly, Timothy.
It's so hot. And I pick up my mom. You wonder why she's tired all the time, because she has to wake up and breastfeed me. And she's been doing this for the past 8 years. I get up. I'm 8 years old now, and my older brother is 12 years old, and he's still breastfed, too. That's why she's always tired. And drunk.
You're her personal cocktail mixer?
She taught me how to mix drinks.
Yeah, I bet you
did. I can make a Long Island, a White Russian, an Irish car bomb. She taught me how to make all these things. She even gave me a little pop-up book that showed me how to mix alcoholic beverages.
How old is your mom?
This show was so funny. I actually did an intro with takes and clips off of this show, and it's right here.
You wonder why she's tired all the time, because she has to wake up and breastfeed me. And she's been doing this for the past 8 years. She even gave me a little pop-up book that showed me how to mix alcoholic beverages. That's why she's always tired. And drunk. No, we're going to be nice. Who's Jesus Christ Superstar? Oh, Ryan. Okay, hang on. Let's pick up Jesus. Okay, Ryan. Hi, Ryan.
Hey, how are you?
Oh, my gosh. I was, waiting for you to go through all the other callers. I was sitting back,
I've seen, so I believe it's in the chat room. Ion Vosh. I own Vosh. Jesus Christ Superstar.
Okay. John,
that's you. John Brand's in the chat room. So is John Ferguson with a zero behind his name. So is Lulz. Easy does it, they got something to say no to. You mad? Is in the room. So is Let Zeke. Late Zeke is in the room. Also is Lol What?
What? It's all desire.
It's all desire. It's all. Mel Gibson's in the room. Moggy Ass. Oh, Moggy Ass has got to go. Goodbye, Moggy Ass. You were spamming the crap out of my show last time. Let me do a chat room shout out. Or you do a chat room shout out. Can you do
that? Me do a chat room. Yeah, you know what? I will do that. I'm going to start with the people that have been around for quite a bit. And he's Rudy, are you still here? No, I can do Alcoholic, Anonymous, Artie Mine, Brooklyn Baller, Carl, CJ, Johnson, Ching Chong Potato, Cook Block, Cuntface, Danielle O'Brien, Dimitri, all these guests.
Right back in. I'll be right back.
All right.
Look for the AAAs.
Sean Newell is in the room. Sippy Cup S.N. Snow is in the room. Street Fighter R.Y.U. is in the room. So is Three Aboo. So is Trollja Boy and Wild Goose. And What the Fuck Is This Crap is in the room.
Trollja Boy.
I like, this one girl, my, you say that we're related.
I'm on the air?
You're on the air.
Hey, hi, Debi. How are you?
Notice he said hi.
So,
this isn't working at all. Anyway. I've seen this copy poster.
We're no strangers to love.
Mike. We got a good following tonight, so it's pretty
yeah,
cool.
Yeah, Jesus Super.
I know. Yeah.
You feel better now?
That's what I'm feeling. Well, I do, but okay. I just don't know if I should tell my lover about my.
All right, if this is a serious question, I definitely think that you should tell him.
All right, it sounds good because, you know, and it was just a really big misunderstanding. Well, it wasn't, but. I love my other lover very much.
We love
and
you.
And thank you.
We love you.
Oh, thank you. Well, I might call again some other time.
We'll be
right
back.
You are very lovely.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
He was talking to me, Debi.
Shut up. He was
Bye-bye.
Talking to me.
No, I'm the lovely one in this room.
All right. Let's go back and pick up Goosey because he said he turned his alternate off. Goosey, are you there?
Word.
Word. All right. We have 913-412-000-949-770. So let's pick up 412. You are on the air.
Yo, I would just like to say, what's up with yourself?
I don't know. Goose, what's up with yourself?
I the same thing that's up with me is up with you. So.
All right.
What do you mean? What's up with me?
Question.
What's up with you?
412, can
well, what's up with me is up with you, and what's up with you is
wait,
up with
me. Wait. Let Debi talk. Let Debi talk. It's always nice to let the ladies talk every once
are
in a while.
Are you in Pittsburgh, 412?
Hell yeah, I am.
Look at me, psychic. Look at that. How about that?
It's really not that hard since I have an area code.
Blow
like,
me. All right, what else?
Dude, area code's a serious business.
Don't joke
but,
about
Don't fuck
anyway,
about area codes.
I like this one girl. You say that we're related. And I'm starting to have feelings towards her.
Put it in your butt.
11. Hello?
Yes, we're listening, Angel.
Put it in her butt.
It's
really all you gotta do.
No, I just put it in her butt, just straight up, just like.
Just straight up in there.
Stick it in the pooper.
Just like,
just
straight up in
just
there.
Sneak in, just go, whoa.
Thank you, thank you for your
call. Surprise as you
sir.
Do it.
Thank you. Go Steelers. All right. Area code 949, you are on the board. I got to go fast or everybody's going to get all pissed off. Area code 949, you are on the air.
I'm on the air?
You're on the air.
Hey. Hi, Debi.
Hi.
How are you?
Notice you said hi. Go ahead.
I've got a couple questions. I've been dating my girlfriend for like 2 or 3 years now. Well, it's technically 3 years, but
how old is she?
And
mm-hmm.
What's that?
How old are both of you?
I'm 23. She's 21.
I'm gonna run downstairs and get my thing I had from La Madeleine, my Caesar salad. Okay, so keep talking.
Okay. You're 23. She's 21.
Yeah. So
anyway,
we're expecting a kid, you know, obviously. So, not obviously, but so I got pregnant, and at first, you know, I was freaking out, shocked, whatever, but I'm a nice guy, you know, I'm not going to run out on her or whatever. And so I told my dad, you know, like his first impression was like, you know, he's like, son, I'm point, you know, and you know, he's always been he's always been like, and hero to me, so it really meant a lot, like, when he was really...
Dude,
okay.
You are where you're talking to a fellow 4chaner at the moment, right?
Well, you know, I mean, you'll understand then. You'll understand my circumstance, so...
This isn't working at all.
Anyway,
I've seen this copypasta.
No, so, well, what happened was, like, so that went down, anyway.
Oh, wait, no, God, Debi, please don't.
Beyond the point of redemption, man. This failed troll. Just exit while you can.
Yeah.
If I don't, you're going to be stuck with this one caller, so.
I'm okay with yeah, all right, yes. Just open it up, I guess.
I'll unmute 303. 303, you're unmuted.
How's it going, 303?
Take your time, and then 303.
Bail.
913, can I unmute you? Will you be good?
Yep.
All right, good. Wait your turn. I'll be right back, guys.
We're no strangers to love.
Let's talk about snakes.
All right, let's talk about snakes.
The legless amphibious creatures.
Yes, they are.
They live in semi-arid climates as well as desert climates.
Oh.
How about them crocodile hunters?
I know all about the crocodile hunters.
Sure
look
is.
At snakes.
Going in here.
And they're quite long, and they're almost like coiled up pieces of shit. And they're venomous like a piece of shit, except shit doesn't bite you. Can you imagine reaching into your toilet, not that I do that, and thinking that there's a piece of shit in there?
How's everybody in the chat doing tonight?
They look like they're enjoying the tunes. You should probably play some more Rick Astley.
I could. Dimitri, you suck, faggot. Thank you. Thank you very much, bro. Wait, you should be taking off. If I could, I would, Ching Chong.
Nice. Fap, fap, fap. Hi. Great. You suck, faggot. Doing well. Fucking bored. Waiting to be taken off hold. This show sucks. Bro, I'm so bored. So I can continue my fapping. Steve's so sensitive. Bored. Alright, fuck you. Bored. I just started skateboarding again. Tired. No. And my multiple sclerosis is hurting. Hadouken! This channel. More fapping. I am a faggot. Making me rage. Stop reading. We can all read. Is that nigga Steve still her? Has gone. Fuck this show. To shit. Lol. Oh, wow. What the fuck is this shit? I'd take you out in Street Fighter. Stop
dude,
reading.
Dude, fuck you. I would take you
Alexa
out in Street Fighter.
Cock.
No.
Look, stop typing. Ken is better.
Who the fuck? Oh, yeah. Now, Ken fight. Is a little bit better.
Akuma is better. My dick went lit.
Who's that,
Yeah. I challenge you on PSN. A new challenger appears. Smiley. I am gay. Let's go. What?
Hey,
I like tips. We can read for you.
Stop. My
bone.
Stop.
You mad? Fact,
hey, stop. Stop. You Street Fighter fans, who's that giant-ass guy? The one for Super Nintendo. He's big, and I think he has an afro.
Fucking fine. No, I didn't really play Super
Nintendo. Smegma? Black Man. Well, whoever he is, I can't fucking get past him. That's pretty much the only trouble I'm having with the game. It's just a black man. Well, yeah, dude, I can't get past those black people.
Did all the trolls just take over the show on air?
Yeah. Sorry, man. I kind of led
yeah.
that.
Oh, well.
I actually
well,
started
there with you. I feel unprepared. Oh, thank God. I was just reading off shit from the chat.
Afro Thunder.
And talk. Second.
Danielle, I would love to cuddle with you.
I have a headache from these headphones. I've had them on for like 5 hours. Stop it.
Ching Chong Potato, what is your area code? No, no, we can't. 770, can you unmute 770?
I can do that, maybe. 770, you are on the air, sweetie. Go ahead.
Oh, yeah.
No. Not again, buddy.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
You're still going.
No. 951, you're on the air. What is it? Goose, stop it.
What?
I put Goose on mute. Goose is a bad troll. He's horrible.
Is he?
Oh, he's horrible.
Sounds like he was having a good time.
Listen to my son coming home on his motorcycle. Listen. Can you hear it?
I can.
That's him getting home on his motorcycle. All right. Let's do a quick unmute of everybody, which is hysterical. And then we'll come back. We'll take a couple more calls. And then I think I'm going to get off because I have a migraine headache. What is that?
That would probably be me typing.
All right. Sorry, I was eating my salad. Okay. We're going to unmute Wild Goose, Pitbull, Unknown.
Come on now. It's you.
Very serious. I get a call from King. I didn't know that. Well, no, I did know it was him. He calls in. I answer the call. And he goes on to tell me, Debbie, I've got to tell you something that happened on Christmas, and I'm not very proud of it. He goes into this story about how he – let me pick him up and see if he remembers this. King, are you still there?
Hello, King. Debbie.
Oh, is that you?
Yep, this is me.
Do you remember that troll call that you did? So he, you go into telling me this story about how you had come home from Christmas on leave, I believe. I could be wrong, from the armed forces, or I could be wrong. And he goes into telling, and I'm buying into this, and I mean, I'm buying it hook, frickin' line, and sinker, okay? And he goes into telling me how, what was it? You beat up your wife, okay?
And I said, oh, my gosh, that's terrible. And then he says, I looked over and the kids are going, Daddy, Daddy, don't. And he says, so I just proceeded to beat the shit out of those little bastards, too. And he just goes off into telling me. And all of a sudden, he just cracks up laughing. And it was really an excellent troll. And what I believe is an excellent troll, and I'm not really a troll, is when you get somebody to believe something and then you kind of just catch them, you know what I mean, King?
I do.
I'm going to pick up letter
That's
A.
That's the fun part.
Letter A?
Skype caller.
Yes, whatever. It says A. What's up? Ryan is back on with us, too. If he'll stop banging that keyboard with his Cheeto-stained fingers.
Wow.
Ouch.
Wow.
Wow. Oh,
that was kind of a bitchy statement.
It was bitchy. Mommy has a headache, Angel.
Wow.
I'm sorry, my love. It's like
fuck you.
Yeah, Debbie, you can get away with anything as long as you tell people you're a veteran to start off, because then they're immediately sucking your dick, you know? I mean...
Oh, I fell for it.
I'm not a veteran. There's no way in the world
I
would be dumb enough to join the fucking military. I mean, that's ridiculous, but the... But immediately, you know, you call and you say, oh, yeah, I was in Afghanistan, right, in the Navy or whatever, whatever Goose's fake military story is that I hear him go on about, which is hilarious to me. Because it just makes people, you know, maybe he just gets it but he's an ace troll, man, and Goose, he's amazing.
I've got the worst fucking headache. It's like I can't talk. It's hurting so bad. I know it's
good. You know what? You deserve it, Cheeto-stained fingers.
Well, you're over there going like this. You're going...
Yeah, sorry. It's the mic is right near the keyboard.
I know.
It's,
I don't mean
like,
to be
on it.
Seriously, I don't mean to be ugly.
You know what? I'm going to tell another terrible joke.
All right, go.
Am I really allowed to do this?
Jane, are you on the... You've been on the air, darling. There's
yeah, that was before.
There's another letter A on the board now.
Hello?
We can hear you.
Hello?
How did y'all get to say letter A?
Hi, this is Vince from Australia.
Oh, no.
Oh, Vince.
Get rid of this.
How are you going to that?
I hate Australians.
I like Vince.
Debi, dump him.
Yes.
Debi.
Yes.
Could you seriously answer the first question I asked?
No.
Because it's actually a point I want to get across.
I forgot it. I was gonna do an extension, but baby.
Globally speaking, in reference to the industrialized Western world, do you think the government incentives for green energy tech development are sufficient?
I don't.
You don't think they're sufficient?
Did I hang up on Jane?
No.
Oh, good. Because you were both Skype callers with the letter A. So let me unmute Veg something. I can't see because I took my contacts out. God damn, his headache's killing me.
He didn't last long.
No. Bye, Vince.
Go ahead.
Hello.
Veg. Yes. Go. Hurry.
Oh, hey, Debi. Why don't you smoke my pole?
Oh, blow me. Area code.
That was fucking honking. That was Stephen fucking
honking. No. What the fuck, Debi?
Who was it?
That's amazing.
Why did you meet Stephen Hawking?
Radio program.
Stephen the fucking Hawking.
Eric.
And I think he's
949, make it count.
Hello, am I on?
Yes, you are on.
You are.
Okay, great. I'm actually calling in because I am a fellow 4chaner, and I've been kind of following this. I know there's other 4chaners in here, and I'm wondering, I kind of want you guys to talk about why this happens, because I'm not really, it's kind of new to me, and I'm kind of interested in it.
You're blowing rules.
Yeah, dude, you're destroying rules 1 and 2. You're killing me.
I believe that you guys have already far destroyed those rules.
Pretty much. But what's your question?
But I'm really wondering, like, I think it's kind of an interesting social experiment. I kind of want to get your guys' thoughts, like, on some of the things, like, you know, Admiral Akbar, Advice Dog, you know, Bear Grylls, you know, Capture a Serial Guy, you know, like Dad Ash, Depression Dog, Derp, Engineer Professor, Forever Alone, you know, Shell Bachelor of Frog, Good Guy Greg. Velociraptor, Picture Unrelated, Pokemon, Becca Black, Hackmaster, Kirk Kurzweil, Sexy Sagan, you know, Mary Mo Vase,
Motherfucker,
Colstein, Zuckerberg, Longlayer Christina, you know, Sad Fry, Pine Pool, you know, things like that. You got Good Dad, you got Hipster Kitty, you got Inglip, you got Ladies Love, you got lame but cool, you know. You got things like that. You got nine cats.
Oh, man, those are some dead memes.
Christ, I hate
you. You know what? Though, I've got to say that that is a classic example of what could have been a fail troll ultimately transforming.
No, that was fantastic.
That was good.
Even said some memes I haven't heard since, like, really, really, really late 2005.
So would he be an
you
old
know, if I was sitting next to you, I would
he's
punch
definitely
you in the
an old
face.
Piston, good morning. How are you, Mr. Piston?
Somebody's got to explain this fag thing. What is this old fag, new fag crap?
Oh, God.
Ryan will do that.
Should I do it, guys? Tell me in the chat box if I should do it.
Ryan?
What are you going to ask somebody? Just do it.
Do it. All right. New fags are...
Wait a minute. Hold on. Stop a second.
Yep.
One guy writes in there, do it, bitch, and you say, oh, okay, I'm going to do it?
Pretty much.
Where's my snare? I have no snare in my headphones. There you go. Yeah. Yo. Have you ever been hated or discriminated against? I have. I've been protested and demonstrated against. Picket signs for my wicked rhymes. Look at the times. Sick is the mind of the motherfucking kid that's behind. All this commotion, emotions run deep as oceans exploding. Tempers flaring from parents. Just blow them off and keep going. Not taking nothing from no one. Give them hell long as I'm breathing. Keep kicking ass in the morning and taking names in the evening. Leaving with the taste of sour as vinegar in their mouth. See, they can trigger me, but they'll never figure me out. Look at me now, I bet you're probably sick of me now. Ain't you, mama? I'ma make you look so ridiculous now. I'm sorry, mama, I never meant to hurt you.
Hello, I'm Giuseppe, I got something special for you. Ready? Uno, due, tres, cuatro. When I was a boy, just about the eighth grade, mama used to say, don't stay boys, always shoot the pool. Giuseppe gone to flunk a school. Boy, it making me sick. All the thing I gotta do. I can't get to no kicks. I always got to follow rules. Boy, it making me sick. Just to make the lousy bucks. Got to feel like a fool. And the mama used to say all the time, what's the matter you? Hey, got no respect. What do you think you do? Why you look so sad? It's a not so bad. It's a nicer place. Ah, shut up your face. That's my mom, I can remember. Big accordion and solo. Play that thing. Really nice. But soon to come a day, gonna be a big...
We're so sorry.
Gentlemen, chow time.
Fuck you, pig!
Oh, bells on wheels for you then, motherfucker.
Fuck you, pig.
Come on, everybody. Chow time. Chow time.
It's all drama.
Right back to me.
Drama.
Coming right back to me. Right back to me.
Comes in all shapes and sizes.
Coming right back to me. Right back to me.
God's itty bitty surprise.
Coming right back to me. Right back to me.
Why I always got my Glock.
Coming right back to me, right back to me.
Drama, it comes in all shapes and sizes. It either cuts, itty bitty surprises. The Glocks are loaded, so let's go. It's time to create a murder show. Chump suckers in the streets trying to disrespect. Call me Goofy Soprano trying to put fools in check. What happened, everyone was down for their crime? You wanna take that easy life and drop that dime? In the streets of San Jose, that don't work. If you don't got your paperwork, you're lying in dirt. I've seen it before, even my life's expendable. To the next man, you'll see the pressure light on cable. But are you able to sacrifice your life for the table? Underline that fact, if you're a coward, you're gonna get whacked. Pull up to his house while he's barbers lawn, then you attack.
Hi guys, Jake here, and welcome to Debi Daily's Radio Network. On the show, they are talking about fond memories they've had with their children in the past, such as flashing gang signs in Disney World. Did I grab your attention yet? Go to the right and download so you can listen to it on your iPod or any other MP3 device. Anyways, enjoy the show.
I'm trying to show this picture to, I'm trying to take this picture to show it to Jake on my Facebook. It's hysterical. It's my children at Disney World, but I tell everybody it's my daughter. And now listen to me. I tell everybody it's my daughter throwing out her gang signs when she was only 4 years old. Okay, wait till you see this picture. Hold on. Okay, the picture's been taken. Now let me upload it over into Facebook. And this is Jake. You're going to crack up when you see this. I tell everybody it's my daughter throwing up gang signs. But what she was doing is she was eating some ice cream, and this picture is adorable. And she's eating ice cream, and it's got her fingers all sticky. And when I told her, you know, hey, look at mommy and smile and everything, she's got her finger just. Are y'all there?
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Y'all go. Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
We're here.
This is just a goofy, goofy part of the show. It's almost like everybody's hearing the archive or something, you know, because we're just all being kind of goofy and funny. But sometimes it's okay to do this. I mean, I hear people on other shows just doing crazy stuff and just talking. I mean, I don't think we always – I think people just expect my shows sometimes to just always be whatever. And it's not. We're just being goofy right now.
Right.
Everybody talk.
I was enjoying your Atlantis thing. That was awesome.
Hey, let's beef up on that and come back and do more with Atlantis because everybody was really digging that. But you get your get your game face on, and tomorrow night, well, I'll even advertise it on the marquee. I'll say anything you've always wanted to know about Atlantis. I'll even say we're going to have two Atlanteans here or something like that. I'm joking,
well,
of course.
Well, just book it. Can do it as Atlantis. And, oh, come on. I will dig on that.
Debi.
What, babe?
Debi.
What?
Are you're Aquarius, right?
Mm-hmm.
I was reading this thing. I was like, Aquarius sounds like water to me, and Atlantis reminds me of water. So anyway, I looked up on Google. Google's my
morning, everybody. This is Cowboy Radio Speculation Sports. It's Sunday morning. We are, as usual, we are on the east side. We are on the poor side. We are in the shadow of Shady Oak Lake, guarding the last 200 feet before Hopkins kicks in. Because today, you guys, at 1 o'clock here, it's the Raspberry Festival Parade, which we will go to. So today is like a 2.5-hour show. We are live on the poor neck, as usual. And our sky is pink. Ducks do fly upside down. But right now, it's blue sky. It's beautiful. It's hotter than you know what. The treehouse here, as usual, is messy. Kobe the Kitty just did a 40-minute show on Speculation Sports on the other side of the dial. And he kicked it out, called his mother, Johnny J. Utah, introduced him. I tell you what, you guys, I wasn't mean to Jamie. We didn't talk dirty to him at all. This person here, this Chris Saul, no one's anywhere. It's just me and the guest, and who God knows, you're listening all the way through this fiasco, Michelle. My God, you want me to come on the show? You give Cowboy a ring. And Cowboy, yow, I don't like you there. I'm not over-religious, but guess what? I know there's a God up there looking down. I know there's one. I know he's up there, okay? He's and whoever killed that little girl, Kaylee, whoever maybe, if she did, so be it. He'll take care of it upstairs, okay? That was to our show. Johnny J. Utah in overtime went into Speculation Sports and had a lot of fun in that show. So I do appreciate all the downloads. I have two guests in the room. We're hanging out here. We're on the east side of the porch side. We're in the shadow of Shady Oak Lake. The treehouse originates out of Minnesota, and we don't take ourselves that seriously. Occasionally, the big show has been known. We go, the beauty of Blog Talk Radio, all you need is a cell phone and your computer, and that's where your studio goes. I've been done stuff from cruise ships. I've done it from places you don't want to know about. I've had to go into work one time at 8 o'clock in the morning, my computer's out. My brother was out of town one day, and I had to sneak into his, I had a key in the backyard. I had to go into his house and do it from his house. So I've done the show in a lot of different places that no one knows. So the treehouse will travel wherever it's got to go. So to be the treehouse, all you need is a phone and a computer. Remember, TalkShoe is free. How you doing? Abby's in the room. We're in the Pomeranian. How you doing, Abby? How you doing, little girl? She's in the treehouse.
This is True Capitalist Radio.
True Capitalist Radio.
I am your host, the man they call Ghost.
The badass of business.
Give him capitalism or give him death.
That's it. Period.
Broadcasting from his Skyline Office Studios in beautiful downtown Austin, Texas.
You sound fruitier than a box of Fruit Loops, for Christ's sake.
And now, he'll take it from here. Your host, the prognosticator of prognosticators, the man they call
Ghost. Yeah, what's going on, folks? And thank you for tuning in with me to another edition of True Conservative, Jesus Christ, True Capitalist Radio, for Christ's sake. What am I talking about? Let me slap myself into reality here. This is, Jesus Christ. I mean, anyway, this is episode number 65 for all the people that are keeping track with the True Capitalist Radio broadcast. And once again, I want to thank everybody for tuning in with me. If you could please retweet the broadcast.
Goose, what are you doing?
Not much. I just wanted to throw in my two cents of what you were talking about earlier.
I think you're addressing
the cause of addiction.
All right. Please go right ahead and do that. It's very, very, it's very physical. It's very deep. It's very deep. The cause of addiction is very, very physical. I hear the echo. Turn me off.
You know, I might.
Come on.
My headset might be
a little
loud.
You're a professional.
Is that me, or do you have?
Blog Talk Radio.
We were talking on another network, not on this network, but, or should I say, they were talking on another network about some situations going on. Anyway, in case you don't know, I'm under attack right now. Oh, my God, it's ridiculous. I've got it coming at me from all sides, and you can see that it's really, really bothered me. Right. I'm really stressed out about it. I went shopping tonight with Vic. Oh, and here he comes. And we had fun. And then we went to this beautiful Christmas party at these attorneys. Am I not going back in there? Did you just? Okay. I've got on the shortest dress I've ever had on in my life. It's driving me crazy. But. people who live by revenge. They live by the code of revenge, you know, and different families do that, if you know what I mean. Families, crime families are real big on revenge. A lot of people
crap in your lawn, you're going to evidentially step in. It's like, why do you even go to that point to where something like that is going to, you know, be on the line, you know, where somebody's going to come back at you for revenge? You know, you got to prevent stupidity before it comes out of, it becomes like out of controlism, I guess you could say.
Yeah, and it's sort of like sending out a message, right? I mean, are the gangs really that big on the street? Or did you say you're from the Bay Area?
Yeah, I'm from the Bay. I'm from San Jose, California. So yeah, you know, the gangs are but it's not like it used to be, like back when I was growing up, like in the early 80s, beginning of the 90s. That's when it was just all, you know, you had your Bloods, your Crips, your Nathaniels, and your Scraps. And now it's just, you have all these Tagger gangs, you have all these, like, three, four, five little friends all together. They're a gang, you know.
But don't you hang out in a gang for security and for protection and stuff, like, right?
Fellow that actually started the new Black Panther Party, of which he is a member, and he just started the Dallas Black Bar Association. That's a big deal.
So he's part of the new Black Panther Party.
He's also in the NOI.
The Nation of Islam.
Wow. Are you swear that's what that stands for?
The NOI? Yeah, the NOI? Yeah. Rick from Newcastle will tell you that. Yeah. I saw him with the bow tie on, so I thought he might be, you know, maybe he's a Christian in the, you know, maybe he's a, because he hasn't changed himself to a Muslim name. But, I guess he got overwhelming support in Dallas. Now, is the mayor of your city black as well?
They're all black.
Yeah.
Chief of police, mayor, everybody. And the thing that's bad about this guy, John Wiley Price, is he's the one, like Jerry said, Victor, that's hard to know that there's somebody that holds your future of your livelihood in the palm of his hand and has got his finger on the button and has the propensity to get the red ass at you.
He sounds like a guy who'd be very vindictive against any white. I mean, he'd be probably vindictive against anybody. But particularly if you're a white or a Latino who doesn't play by his rules, he will probably give you the good old 1-2.
He gave us the 1-2 and the 3 and the 4. But yeah. I was going to tell y'all something a little bit. There's an FBI affidavit that was actually filed with the federal Department of. I mean, the federal district attorney's office, I don't know how to say that, but it was actually filed at the federal courthouse, meaning here it is, indicting. And he stands, it's a fascinating read. It's a 62-page document. I'll give you guys the link to that document that I'm going to be going over. And then I'm going to tell you.
I'm going to bring on the line right now a very prominent feminist. She hosts her own radio show on public radio, Debi Daly. How are you, Debi?
Oh, why would anybody vacation in Tokyo? What the fuck? What's over there to see?
I don't know. I saw Lost in Translation and I got hooked.
Are you in the red light district?
Yes, you know it, baby.
Is it really all, does it look all, what do you call those lights? What are those lights called? I'm trying to blank. I wasn't ready to start talking today. I've had a quiet day. Ultraviolet. Is it all the buildings lined in ultraviolet lights?
Yes, they are. And if you go...
Is where you spent most of your days. What's going on with you?
I'm armed.
You my gangbanger holding down North Philly?
Yeah,
I thought a lot of that was true. Yeah, even though people may not see that, but yeah, that's a lot of that's very true about me. And then so I think sometimes I kind of come off as a little bit like hostile or maybe like prejudiced on it, and I'm really not. I'm not like that. It's just that I think people hear some of the things I say, and they make assumptions about me sometimes. That does piss me off.
And it is talking a lot about how you worry more about how you were seen or how you were viewed than other people are. Everybody likes you, and you're doing great, but you're your own. You're hard on yourself.
Well, I am very hard on myself. Absolutely, I am. That's just the way I've always been. You know, I can't really do anything about that, I don't think.
And then it goes down. You have to skip all this part. It says, marriage is very important to you, for better or for worse, and you cannot stand being alone. You love business relationships, and you really love partnerships. You are very likable. You're very sociable. You're very sensible to your environmental conditions and surroundings. You like your home, your habits. You're comfortable in your little world. You are very caring and very protective of your loved ones.
I just remembered what this show is. This is actually Rick from Newcastle calling in to get a reading from me, if you can believe that. Rick from Newcastle, I kid you not, Rick from Newcastle called in and asked if I would read him, I guess is what we just called it a personal reading when I used to be on the show. And I can still do it. I just don't do it anymore, really. But this is actually Rick from Newcastle.
Yeah, that's very true.
You are not a person that would happily take... You are not a person who would happily take in a movie by yourself or dine alone. A partner awakens feelings in you that you may never knew that you had, and you seem to need a partner to learn about your own self. Emotional fulfillment is sought through relationships, but you may have relationships one right after another, each time believing that this is the one. Taking time between relationships is something that's hard for you to do, but very necessary, as you tend to jump from one to another out of fear of being alone. You sound a lot like me. You are very sensible to others and usually quite likable as a result. Be careful, though, that you don't become overly dependent upon a partner, or assume that a partner is going to... Now, this is what I need to learn. Or assume that a partner is going to treat you the way you treat them.
Yeah, that's true.
That's one of the biggest lessons that I've had to continue to try to learn in life is, and my daughter even comes to me a lot and says things like, Mom, I don't understand. I'm so nice to blank. And then I get blank and I'm like, well, Heather, you know, just because we treat people a certain way doesn't mean they're going to treat us that way.
Yeah, that's absolutely true. You're right. That's a shame, too. You know, cause that's like how that saying, you know, nice guys finish last. There's a lot of truth to that.
You know, my brother said something to me one time that stuck, and I said to him, David, how can you treat Vic, him, my husband and him, best friends for a long time, played a lot of golf together. I said, how can you treat Vic like that when he's always paying your green fees, he's always buying all the drinks, he's always... this, he's always doing that, and how can you treat him like that? And he goes, and he said something, he said, Deb, listen, if Vic is rich enough to throw his money around like that, hey, I'm going to lap up. And I thought, how mean. I mean, I don't know. I guess I just have a little bit more respect and loyalty or something. I'm not sure what it is I'm trying to say here, but That just reminded me of that for some reason. Uh-huh. It's that there is a conflict here between the head and the heart with you. Your emotions try to tell you one thing, and yet your mind tells you something else. And the result for you, Rick, is a constant seesaw effect. You can sometimes be emotional to the point of irrational and then logical the next. And how to blend the head and the heart is a constant struggle for you.
Yeah, that's pretty close. Like I said, a lot of stuff you're saying is very spot on. But I'm not going to give too many details of what you're saying is spot on. But, yeah, a lot of it is very, very, very accurate.
Very moodiness. It says when, no, check this out. If you don't believe me, I'll screenshot it. When nervous or excited, you talk up a storm. You may, it says, people can usually read your mood by how much you're talking. The more you're talking, the better your mood. Moodiness is a characteristic, definitely, and especially subjective nature makes you prone to hypersensitivity. God, you sound a lot like me. It's also one of the reasons that you tend to be indecisive. You may swing between irrational and rational thoughts and feelings all the time. It's pretty much something that takes place in the mind, although others are sure to see the struggle from time to time. You're always interesting, usually very funny, but you do have a tendency to misrepresent yourself with what you say from time to time. But you are charming and a little kooky.
Well, that's something.
I love.
Like, where are you getting all this from? Is it like a book you have or something?
You off of the time that you were born. No, I'm reading your birth chart.
But where do you get a birth chart? I mean, is it yours that you have? Is it like physically in front of you, or is it like on a computer somewhere?
No, I'm just doing it off my head. No, I'm doing it.
That's pretty impressive if you did.
Generally amiable and project a soft, yielding manner. You possess a natural charm. You are very highly imaginative and sympathetic. You can make an excellent mediator for people. You are keenly aware of your need for relationships and intimacy. You have a well-developed respect for qualities typically associated with feminine.
With what? Feminine.
You respect women.
Oh, okay. I thought you said something else.
If you have a well-developed respect for qualities typically associated with the feminine.
Okay.
So, you respect women. You should enjoy a great deal of personal popularity and success throughout your life, although generally considered and looked at as lucky with relationships and money. This is less about luck than it is about a certain level of inner peace and positive energy that attracts pleasant situations. At times, you can be complacent, almost lazy, and overindulging in the pleasures of life. However, you are a peacemaker at heart, and you have an unusual ability to help and to heal others.
Wow.
It says you have an... What is this word? Let me see what this says. Hold on, I've got a reader that'll read it for us real quick. What is this word?
He has an irresolute nature with sudden changes of humor. He is unstable and does not follow through on his own objectives. This instability shows itself not only in professional life, but also in love life and friendships.
Okay, now this is where it talks about the planets that you were not in line, that you were actually... They call it opposition and conjunct. Do you know what those were?
I have no idea.
Well, certain planets represent certain personality traits and stuff like that.
Okay.
And if, in fact, when we're born, our sun, which is the main thing, our sun is aligned with certain galaxies and stuff, that makes a certain kind of person. And then there's other ones that we are, it says right here, usually quite diplomatic and tactful. He evaluates and weighs things up endlessly, often to the point of indecisiveness. God, that sounds just like me. Of expresses himself clearly. Before coming to an opinion on a subject, he listens to the opinions offered by various people and can compare them before making up his own mind. Mental affinity in his relationships is paramount. He is good at compromising and always tries to put himself in others' shoes. That's me. I mean, I'm freaking out because it sounds a lot like me. His thirst for knowledge is never satisfied. That sounds like me. He is full of mental activity. That sounds like me. Mm-hmm. He undertakes exhaustive studies, always studying for pleasure. He likes journeys in faraway places, and he could even live abroad.
Yeah.
That's
pretty true.
You are externally curious, and you hunger for knowledge. You enjoy studying and learning, and you do it not because you have to, but because you want to. But how come in school, I hated school?
I was the same way. I swear to God, Debi, but now it's like I just try to learn as much as I can and educate myself as much as I can. And, like, if not really, I guess in certain areas, like, I would say, but yeah, it's just I love to study. I love to learn now. But like you said, in school, that was the exact opposite.
I would do anything to get to go into school. The only reason I went was because of cheerleading, drill team, boyfriends, friends, shit like that. Seriously.
It was a social event for you, pretty much.
Listen,
if I forget to tell you, I found the name of that show for you, too. Darrow Carr. Yeah, so whenever you're done, I'll let you know who that was.
We'll let this guy read for us.
You are eternally curious and hunger for knowledge. You enjoy studying and learning and do it not because you have to, but because you want to. You enjoy exchanging ideas and personal philosophies with others. You can be especially buoyant, enthusiastic, and even inspiring in your communications. While you may not pay enough attention to details, you are skilled at finding a quick solution to problems. You readily see the bigger picture and enjoy sharing your opinions and ideas. You get off on how information affects people's lives, and you take great pleasure in learning that something you have shared or taught has inspired others to take action, experience something new, or make changes in their lives. Some of you might be too quick to offer advice. However, that might be lacking in thoroughness and practicality, or that you yourself don't follow.
It's almost like they're reading about me, and that's a good thing, because I'm a good person.
Do you and I share the same, close to the same birth date?
No, absolutely not. Absolutely not. Absolutely not. Nowhere near.
Wow.
No, I'm January. It says you, we're getting close to the end. You are rarely satisfied with your achievements. You like meeting people. You like to be around a good meal in a cordial atmosphere. You are pleasant. You are jovial. You are engaging. This doesn't say anything, but you ought to see mine.
Yeah, that's just trying to flatter me is all you're trying to do. I get it.
You are big, but you are often disappointed with small advancements or successes, wishing they were bigger and better. You may even bring every conversation around to yourself, which is a tendency that should be kept in check. You have highs and lows in your professional life.
Yeah. Yeah. That whole thing you said was absolutely right. Spot on.
Hate routine, whether it's work or home. You fight to keep your independence, and you would gladly remake the world. God, that's a big saying right there.
That is a big thing, isn't it? Yeah. I like that.
You must have an independent career with no routine or you'll go stir crazy. Is that true?
Yeah, in a way, yeah, because I know my last job I had, it was all routine. It's just like, it drove me nuts. It drove me fucking crazy. So the position I have now, it's not always the same thing. It's varied. From day to day, I'm not really sure what I'm doing when I go in there. So it works really well for me.
The field that I've always been in and out of with raising the children and stuff like that has always been in law. And I just will not accept a position unless I first and foremost have my own office. I won't, with a door. With a door I can close.
I don't blame you. That's not too much to ask for.
It says right here that you like isolation. Me too. You can sometimes want more to withdraw, to meditate or whatever you want to do. And there's a lot of times that you have that in your life. It says you use all your energy to succeed professionally. You have a very good sense of organization and authority. Now here we are at the very end. It says a cautious approach to money and finances and possessions. Financial success may be slow, but steady. I'm just going to the last part. Lots of authority within the family. You know how to take the destiny of the family in hand. You are very energetic, very strong, and you know how to handle your setbacks in life. You want a pleasant home, a charming wife, loving and sweet children, nice little meals, pleasant evenings with loved ones. That's the good life to you.
Yeah, can't argue that one.
It says, ooh, listen to this. Marries quite young and divorces later. A second marriage, doubtless with less passion, but with lots of friendship. Frightened of living alone in old age. He is devoted to all causes that bring comfort or help to people in difficult situations. We're at the very end. Adores to debate endlessly with people who don't share his ideas. And listen to this. The discussion can lead to even verbal violence.
Wow. Wow.
Lives a life, dies of natural causes. Wow.
I hope that's true.
Well, you love life. I love that.
I do.
That's great.
I have my rough times, but yeah, I'm getting up there. I'm getting my life back on track now. It was bad for a while, but like you said, it was slow recovery. But I'm doing pretty well now.
That's what it says.
Yeah.
I would love to do. I'm going to punch in, wait a minute, oh, this goes right to you. Find out how others relate to you by clicking on your sign. You are, what are you? I forgot.
Scorpio.
Scorpio, all right. And now, let's see, if your Venus is in Scorpio, it says, it's all or nothing in matters of the heart. You are capable of loving deeply, and you crave intimacy. Scorpio isn't afraid of anything, blah, 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 blah. I was thought that we were going to do, what is your partner right now?
Well, what's my partner, you said?
Taurus, Gemini, what? Your partner, your wife, whatever.
Oh, you know what? I have no idea.
She's...
I wouldn't even really consider her partner, really. He's not at this point.
Because it says how you relate to, and then it gives every, because it's taking this one step further, which I didn't know it did this. Like another one that, you know, like your wife or your girlfriend or whatever, it takes whatever they are, and it tells you how you get along with them. So.
Yeah, that's funny. I'm not even at that point right now, so I'll skip that part.
I wonder what it says about me, because I am Aquarius. It says, this is one of the most challenging of combinations. It can work, but it's going to be hard because you're going to need a lot of understanding. You are likely to be intrigued with her and her with you, but the nature is so intense and personal and very passionate. Ooh, look at that. I was just wondering... We seem alike. It says she can actually be baffled by some of your reactions. And, wow, interesting. So there you have it.
Yeah. I'm telling you, that's pretty intense.
I know, it's crazy. I even read about my children, and you know, the one thing that really got to me is I've always called Heather, my daughter, Queenie, mm-hmm. because there's just always been something about her that seemed like almost like regal or something. And I've always nicknamed her Queenie. Well, the very first line in her birth chart says, there is an air of regalness to you. And I went, there's no way that just said that. There's no way. I know.
That's pretty freaky.
You desire to be surrounded by the finer things of life. She'd live in the Four Seasons if you'd let her.
But yeah, that's some pretty intense shit.
Yeah, it's pretty wild. So there you have it. But getting back to what we were talking about, there is so much in the Bible that has to do with the stars. It's crazy.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. Yeah, because you know that's they mention the stars a lot. You know, and even Lucifer was referred to as the morning star. That's what his name means. Lucifer means morning star.
Well, a lot of people say the sun, you know, is indicative of the sun. You know, the sun, like the son of God. You know, the sun. They've made him.
I think that dates back to some kind of Egyptian belief, I believe, isn't it?
It's wild. This thing that my found the other day. There is a guy that calls into my show all the time, and all I ever call him is the smart guy because he remains anonymous. He calls and he's amazingly smart. And he directed us to a YouTube. He was talking the other night with Anonymous Bill, and there were a lot of people on the call, but he directed us to a speaker, an author, this guy by the name of Bill Donahue. Donahue? It's like D-O-N-A-H-U-E, I believe. And he might be. I don't think he's I don't think he claims any religion. Have you ever heard of him?
Yeah, I'm pretty sure he's the head of the Catholic, some kind of Catholic League or something like that.
Maybe, but he gives these talks, these lectures, and he compares the Bible. He sort of almost like doesn't believe. I mean, I don't know. It's really. I haven't figured him out yet. We've been listening to him for the last couple of days, and I really haven't got a fair read on him. But it's some of the most amazing stuff I've ever seen. Area code 919, you are on the air with Debi and with Rick. What's up?
Hey, how you doing, Miss Debi?
I'm doing great. How are you?
I haven't talked to you in about a year or so.
Mel. Is this Mel?
Yeah, this is Mel.
Wow, I have a good memory. I'm just talking to you. I had a chance tonight for the first time ever to talk to Rick, and I'm enjoying talking to Rick. What can I do for you, Mel, and how are you?
I'm doing well. How about yourself?
Doing all right. Doing really, really good. Doing fine, actually. Say hi to Rick.
Hey, hi, Rick.
Hey, how you doing, Mel? Nice to meet you.
Nice to meet you, too. You guys had a good dialogue going. I didn't know whether to tune in, jump in, or just kick back and kick my feet up.
Jump at any time.
Well, one time back when I used to do readings, and she said something to me, and I said, you are surrounded by somebody that is dark. And I meant a dark spirit.
Like
something
evil.
Yeah, sort of like that. Tell me what happened, Mel, how I was spot on.
That person, let me see, I think that was a roommate of mine, and they moved on to get their own place, and they had a child, and actually they're doing pretty good, to be honest with you. He's been on his own for about 2 years, and we still keep in contact. He's doing fairly well for himself.
Yeah, but the dark place he was in?
As far as the dark place, I think, you know, slowly but surely getting some good results, you know, had a lot to do with relationships.
Just saying at the time, when he called me, he admitted that he was in a very dark place. remember? In his
right.
life.
Wow.
That was, yeah, it was weird. I was like, wow. Maybe I am psychic. No.
I've had a psychic reading before.
No, I used to do readings on here. Do you ever deal with the person that had the children that you were trying to, like, hook up with? I even guessed that, too, Mel. Remember?
Yes, you do.
I said, you have got somebody that does not live near you that you want to be with, but there's a reason, there's problems, and it has to do with the child.
Well, that person actually ended up moving here to the state of North Carolina, and we're still together to this day.
Remember, I guessed that? I was like, Jesus Christ. I just remember Mel she called back several different times because I was just reading the crap out of her, Rick.
Well, how long ago was this?
Oh, not that long, about a year ago, maybe.
Okay.
About the beginning of 2011, the end of 2010. Yep.
Yep, it was pretty wild, I remember. But what brings you to the air tonight?
Well, you always got great conversations, and this is the first night I've ever heard you speak about birth charts and stuff, and so, you know, I just wanted to tune into some good convo and see what you had, you know, was talking about tonight. And
Mel is the coolest of the cool. Her real name's Mary.
Melanie.
Okay, I got it. I said Mary's my ex-wife's name.
Well, great. Then sit back, and I'll just continue talking to Rick about what we were talking about, and if you want to chime in.
Sure.
You've got a nice, quiet connection, so that's not a problem. But, Rick, we were talking about that guy, possibly Donna Who, Donna Ho, Donna something. I don't remember the damn name. But
okay,
Whenever this guy that calls in, I think he lets me refer to him as Pete. Whenever Pete calls in, this guy is just a genius about all things that have to do with, you know, politics, with everything. He called in and was telling us that by virtue of the fact that the name on our driver's license is in all capital letters, that we are considered I might get it wrong, like a corporation or something. He was talking about, federal laws like something Title 28. Do you know anything about that, Rick?
I've never heard of it.
Oh, okay. I didn't know what you were. I didn't know if you were more into. I really don't know about you, Rick, and I really want to know more about you. What is your platform in life? If you were like a presidential nominee, what do you stand for in life? What is your big issue?
All right, you know what? It's, I tell you, me personally, I am, as far as my political beliefs go, I am would be considered a right winger and an extreme one of that. But I'm not a hater, and I don't think we should oppress anybody. It's just that I have very traditional values, and I think I see them slipping away in today's society, and it seems like we're going downhill, and I yearn for just a traditional way the way things used to be. It just seems like, you know, it's just society's falling apart, the family structure is crumbling, and I stand for all that.
You stand a lot for conservation of the old ways that things were, and I believe I couldn't agree with you more. I think that we've messed this whole thing up.
Yeah, absolutely. I think there's a lot of different reasons, you know, that the family structure is falling apart, as far as, you know, the mother going in the workforce, you know, thinking that she had, you know, that pursuing a career was more important than staying at home, and I don't think it is. It's just that the whole family structure has been just decimated, and I think it has a lot to do with the condition of society today.
I stand for that, Rick. I told my husband when we got married, I said, if you make $20,000 a year, we will live in a $20,000 home, I will drive a 73 Buick, but I will raise my goddamn kids.
Yeah, and you know what? It's I can all, like I said, I'm divorced now, but I look in hindsight, I should have never done that. It was a mistake. Yeah, if I can go back and do it again, you know, it's just that I should have tried harder.
What was the mistake?
It's I got selfish. I got just too involved in myself. And I mean, I didn't like neglect my kids or anything like that. That's not what it was about. It's just I got too wrapped up in my own life, and she did too. It's just we just kind of decided, that, you know, that this wasn't working, and we just kind of split.
Who raised your kids? Did you have a stay-at-home mother?
Yeah, for the most part, yes. But ever since the divorce, which was years ago, I've had them full-time.
Do they go to a daycare center or
no?
What?
Well, my boys are 12 and 14 now, so they're a little bit older. Mm-hmm. So basically, yeah, they go down to my mom's house every once in a while because she loves to have them down there, you know, whenever, like, there's nobody at my house, but... But yeah, I have them pretty much full time. I mean, the mother sees them sometimes, but just due to the different reasons, she can't see them as much.
I understand. And don't get me wrong, Rick. I don't feel that every mother, just by virtue of the fact that they gave birth, is a great mother.
No, I agree 100%. And in fact, I would take it a step further that if a mother isn't involved, even though she's not doing anything bad per se, but if she's not involved and take a conscious effort in their life, to me, that equals a bad mother.
Absolutely. I think it could be devastating to the child.
Yeah, it is. Absolutely.
Very much so, to have an absentee mother. I knew a woman when I lived in Plano, no names, and she had tons of money. She was very, very wealthy. And anything that went wrong in those children's lives, she had three children, she still does, she would hire it out, like if they wanted to talk. I mean, it was so sad that if they came home and said, Mom, I need help with English, she'd get an English tutor. Mom, I'm having trouble getting along with people, take them to a shrink. Mom.
I'm sorry, go ahead.
They were constantly with nannies, babysitters. I mean, I thought to myself all the time, why in the hell did this woman have these kids?
Yeah, I agree. I mean, don't have the kids if you're not going to be able to raise them yourself. And, you know, I also think, too, I mean, a mother, is, like you said, you know, there's nothing more important than having the mother in the kid's life. But I think it's equally important, too, for the father. And I think a lot of times that, and I'm not saying that you're saying, you know, that that's not true, but I think a lot of times the father kind of just kind of gets lost in the background sometimes.
You're damn right. Not even, let's don't even go to the legal system. The legal system works against the father being in the case of a divorce.
Oh, it does.
And let me tell you something. I think Mel will agree. There are some pretty shitty mothers out there. Some I've known in my own life that I feel sorry for the kids. It's
absolutely
sad.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm. But today it just seems like it's accepted.
Not
like,
in my
world. It's so many kids come from, you know, and I understand it's not, you can't help it sometimes, but from broken homes, it's just, like I said, me myself, looking in hindsight, you know, it's just, I should really manned up. But I didn't.
But that is what shapes and molds our world, is our upbringing. I mean, the way Barack Obama runs this country has everything to do with the way he was raised.
I agree with that.
It's not what we learn in college. I mean, I've sat back long enough and observed my two kids that are now, both are over 21, and I can see that what I did, and I say me because although Vic was there, he was always running business, but I was the one that was there in the grind day in, day out, day in, day out. And I can see where every damn move I made, they took note of.
Yeah, absolutely, and that's lacking largely in today's society. It's, you know, it just seems, you know, for whatever reason, the mother has to work, you know, because they need to, you know, or have two jobs. But like you said, though, Debi, I mean, it's, no matter how much you make, you could always get by.
If you're married and your husband is employed, gainfully employed, and is going to stay that way, and you have to work, I believe, and you have children, you're living beyond your means.
Yeah, you know what, I can see that. It's almost like a greed, even though they may not realize it.
Yep.
Yeah, I agree. Like I said, to me, like maybe, you know, I didn't think this way at the time when I was married. I tell myself anyway, it was just immaturity. But I think it's best, you know, for a family to have a set of very well-defined responsibilities between the man and the woman. And they're equally responsible. It's not to say that, you know, the woman is less of a, you know, of a person because she's staying at home, you know, holding down the home front. You know, that's arguably even more important than what the guy does. You know, but at the very least, you know, it's at least as important as what the guy does.
Rick, I lived stay-at-home mom cocktail dinners all the time with Victor because he would have to go to judges' dinners, Christmas parties after Christmas parties. You know, big judges and lawyers were there and district attorneys, prosecutors, you know, everybody was there. And I would be, you know, walking around with Vic on his arm and, you know, in my little black dress and looking just perfect, spot on. They would meet me and say, oh, you're Victor's wife. Well, what do you do? I'm a stay-at-home mom. And the conversation would be like, oh, okay. You know, mm-hmm. And I was raising I was raising citizens. And, you know, it wasn't looked upon, like you said, as a very sexy job or whatever.
And it wasn't. But to me, like I said, it must be because I'm older and I see things a little bit different. But, yeah, I think that is – that's arguably more important than what the father does, and to chalk that, you know, to rob children of that these days, to, you know, whether they come from broken homes, I mean, it has to have irreparable, you know, irreversible damage on our society.
Mel, was your mother there when you got home from school every day?
Mm-hmm. She was.
No, I came from a household where the mother and father worked. So, but my father had full custody. My mom had, you know, the summertime and every other weekend.
Hey,
fine.
I'm intrigued.
But it wasn't damaging. It wasn't damaging because that's always been a tradition in my family. Both parties have always worked. Every now and then, I'll come across an aunt and uncle who had a relationship to where the man worked and the woman stayed at home. So, and, you know, there's no way that a man can work full-time and then come home and know every single need of the child. There's no way. You know, a stay-at-home mom knows the food that needs to be bought. They know to keep areas clean. They teach. A lot of the teaching comes from that nurturing from the mother first. So
yep.
my household was broken, but it wasn't damaging to my brother and I because...
Well, why did your mother lose? Why did your mother lose custody of you guys?
Well, I'm not really sure. I think it was just, you know, my mom and dad had some differences between them. But as far as what was best for raising us and who had the most time, my dad had the most time, and my mom didn't have as much time as far as the jobs were concerned. My dad had a flexible schedule when it came to work. My mom did not have a flexible schedule, so it was best that my dad took full custody because he had the most flexible time and schedule to be able to take care of us as much as we needed.
There wasn't any. She's not fit to be a mother or anything like that going on.
The only unfit thing that my dad seen may have been her lesbian lifestyle. She had a lesbian lifestyle. But other than that, on every other level, she was there. It was just her, you know, after-work activities that maybe my dad didn't really like.
Talk about that for a second. That's intriguing. Rick, Mel, if you don't mind me saying, you are lesbian.
Yes.
Okay.
Yes.
Now, I have heard different theories on lesbianism. I have heard a lot of people, and I'm not saying this is what I agree to, but I'm just telling you what I've heard. I have heard a lot of people say that lesbian is a learned thing more so than a homosexual male. That I have a lot, my heart is with the homosexual male because I know that it's something that is born in them. Now I've heard the opposite with women. What do you feel about that? And do you mind talking about that? Are you comfortable talking about that for a second?
Yeah, I'm fine.
Rick, have you ever heard that women will turn to women because of their disdain for men, things along that line? Have you ever heard that?
Yes, I've heard that. And it's funny you actually mentioned that because I actually read something today, I can't remember exactly where, but talked about how women were more inclined to turn to lesbianism, like because of their relationship, they kind of, even if it's not intentional, that they kind of, the relationship that they gain with other women, this is for like the emotional end of it.
Their disdain for men.
Yeah, yeah.
What do you feel about that, Mel? I mean, we've got one right here live on the show with us. That, Mel.
Yeah, well, you know, I try to stay away from the labels. You know, it is what it is, but I really don't label myself anything other than Melanie. But, you know, if we're talking about lesbians here, I definitely can comment. I have been with men as well, so, you know, I've been on both sides, and I don't hate either or, you know. But as far as it being a learned behavior, I mean, I think your whole life is a learning experience. I don't think you have to learn how to be straight, and I don't think you have to learn how to be gay either, because I've been with good men and I've been with some shitty men. So, you know, even when I was dating men, I had to learn, you know, how to be with a man and their needs and their wants, and you know, I had to, you know, learn how to deal with a shitty man, and I had to learn how to deal with a really good man. And then on the same side as women, I've been with some shitty women and I've been with some great women. So, you know, everything is a learning experience to me, and I don't think that I was born straight. I don't think that I was born gay. I think I was just born me. And when I started dealing with persons, places, and things, I had to learn on all types of level. So, you know, if you're married, you have to learn how to function in a marriage and a serious commitment. And if you're living in a gay lifestyle, you have to learn how to deal with the up and down emotions that it takes to deal with a woman. So it's all learning. And I don't know. I don't think that people are born gay or straight. I think people are just born, and when they come here, they just make a decision about who they want to deal with. If I found a guy that had the same qualities that I liked in a female, then I would deal with the guy. And it just so happens I found a female that has the same qualities that I like. And so that's the decision that I made.
But I find that a lot of gay men are repulsed by the thought of having actual sex with a woman. Have y'all heard that?
I've heard that.
Oh yeah.
That's because they want to be women. A lot of gay men will hang out with a female, and they don't want to hang out with a female because they, you know, they like you. They want to hang out with women because they want to be you, and they're trying to learn the woman behavior. And once they've learned all they need to learn, then they go act out that woman behavior with their male partner. So a lot of men don't want to have sex with women because they want to be one.
Amazing. I've never heard that theory. I don't know.
Well, that's pretty. But you know what? She makes sense because where I used to work, I had a good friend of mine. He was married. He had a kid. He was same age as me. And he real manly, had tattoos, like heavy metal. We used to go to concerts. And it was a steel mill. He worked in a steel mill with me. And recently, he was like a bigger guy. You know, we used to go to the gym. It was just, you know, a lot of us did that. You know, a lot of us were friends in the steel mill. We used to hang out. And here I found out within the past couple of years, he had got a divorce, and he has had a total 100% sex change. He's a woman now. And he still works down in the steel mill. That's just, to me, it just blew my mind. Because I would have never, ever thought that about him. I mean, because it came out of the blue. I mean, it's just unbelievable. Unreal.
That is odd.
Can't you, like, I mean, both things, if I could ask you, like, whenever a guy's gay, can't you, like, pretty much tell, even if they say they're not, I mean, can't you pretty much tell the ones that are, like, closet gays, you know, just trying to, like, hide, you know, be in the closet or not, can't you pretty much pick them out?
Yeah, I can. I agree. I can. I have seen married men in my life that I have known.
Hey, guys. I'm back. I was out walking one of the dogs, and, you know, it's like once I start walking with one of my dogs, I just walk and walk, and I turn around and I think, God, I'm so far away from home. So I'm sorry that show went on and on and on, but right when I left, I had put, how long has that show been going? That show has been on, see, 134, 107. Wait a minute. I walked for over an hour. Yeah, it does seem that way because I'm burning up. But anyway, so there's a little bit of more sneak peek into what my show used to be like. And again, you know, I could just go on and on and on and play and play. And you will see there's no hate on my show. I don't talk bad about people. So again, everything you hear, and I mean everything you hear, is total, absolute bullshit about me. Okay, I'm Debi with you. Until the next time I do this, I will see you on the flip side or in the funny papers.